So this is about GDB on S390X and the problems, or so, at least some of the problems that we have been seeing over the years by now and still not fixed. Some of them are not easy to fix or mostly impossible to fix maybe even. I made a selection that might be of interest to others, not just to the S390 folks. So hopefully you are not bored to death, but it's still possible that you are falling asleep, I don't know. Let's see. So I'm talking about five major issues that I stumbled into on S390X. Let's start with the first one. The first one is about return values. Return values usually work, but there are also cases where they don't on S390X. And this is one example here where the return value has a type of long double. A long double return value is not passed in registers. And then GDB claims that the contents cannot be determined. So the same happens, of course, if you are trying to return from a function that has such a return type and pass the return value to it. Then also GDB doesn't know where to store that return value. So basically, GDB doesn't know the location of the return value at this point. And why is that the case? Basically, there are two ways the return value can be passed. One way is directly in a register. It could be a general purpose register or a floating point register. And the other way is to pass the return value in a memory location that is indicated, or whose address is indicated by a hidden argument that is passed by the caller, right? And the hidden argument is passed in R2. R2 is usually used as the first integer type argument and is called clobbered. So because it is called clobbered, it cannot be unwound. And it is certainly not available to finish or to return. Yeah, you can see this also in this example where GDB indicates that register 2 is not saved when you go one frame up, right? The problem is not specific to Z or to S390. It also applied to some other platforms at least 20 years ago or even more. I don't know how old this bug really is. I haven't digged into the GNATS files. The bug really was not about fixing this because it was seen as a limitation, I think, at that time. The bug was really about fixing the test cases. And the test cases are still not fixed today, so. But actually, we can do better than that. We cannot just fix the test case. We could do some more, at least, because the entry value of R2 is often available, at least if there is call site information for the place where we called the function. And in that case, we have, or in this example here, we have dwarf information at the call site that describes the location of R2. So in this case here, we could reconstruct it. So one approach would be to basically exploit that information, to exploit the call site information for unwinding that register, and then to access the return value through that. Quote unquote, $R2 at entry, but that's actually not a valid expression right now in GDB. So I hope that's clear. Any questions to that? I guess you need a...
So on architectures, like I guess pretty much anyone, any architecture, when a function returns a structure, if I remember correctly, it's also something like that where you pass a hidden pointer to the return value. Is that right? Yeah. So it kind of looks like this. How does it work on these in these cases? So if you have
a structure is passed in the same way as, what do you mean?
So
on
if
a different architecture,
if let's say on x86, if a function returns a structure,
yeah.
If I remember correctly, the caller pass allocates the, like if it's returned by a value, and the caller allocates a space and passes to the callee a pointer to that space.
I don't know this. Do you know the x86 64 ABI?
Yeah. So this is true that this way of returning via invisible argument, via invisible pointer, of course, is done for structure on many other platforms, and it is also the case that in all these cases, you can't see the value and you can't do the return. The thing is, because that doesn't work on any platform, there is no GDB test case. But for long double, that works on most platforms. Mm-hmm. Therefore, there are test cases that test long double, and those all fail on our platform, because just on our platform, for some mistakes that were made historically in our ABI definition, we're using the same method also for long double, even though it would really have been better to return long double in a register pair.
Okay.
But yes, if we did something like that, that would also fix the case for structs in many cases on all other platforms. So
yeah. So my point was not to point out S390 as
is not wrong, the only affected platform here. Yeah.
Yeah. So point out that it's a broader problem than just.
Yeah, it's a broader problem.
So
yeah.
Thanks for pointing it out. I didn't know about that.
So the inability to find R2, right, that's because it's called clobbered. So presumably that's what that's meaning is in the prologue to your function that is going to do this return, it's stashed R2 away somewhere and you can't find it. Could you not nag the compiler developers to emit dwarf to tell you where R2 can be found? Because if that dwarf existed, then you would be able to unwind R2, and would that problem not solve itself at that point?
Well, that's what this is, right?
The function being called doesn't really care about R2 being destroyed.
Right.
It's just the caller has to remember where it reserved the area for the return value, and then he passed that address to the callee, but the callee doesn't really care about preserving R2. That's the problem. So the callee is not preserving R2.
And in fact, the compiler does inform GDB that where the R2 might be
that's
located.
What this
that's
is.
What the call side parameter thing is about, right?
Right. Yeah, the unwind information would not provide that unwinding of R2, because the unwinding refers to the callee, not the caller. But the call side information refers to the caller. So the caller has some information about how to reconstruct R2. The callee does not have that, right? The callee does not care about unwinding R2.
I think the confusion is that we're not reconstructing R2, you know, or we are in a way when it was the value of R2 when we called the function. But really what we're reconstructing is actually the location where that we asked the function being called where to save the return value.
Yeah.
So there's two concerns I think that you're referring to. The one is the callee. If the callee returns a value at that point where you generate code to return the value, that code will have to know where to write that value. So at that point, that address must be known somewhere, which may not be in R2 anymore. It may be somewhere else.
Yeah.
So throughout many places in the function history before you get to that return, this value will still be known somewhere. And that could be specified in debug information for the callee, which it currently is not. But so it currently is not in debug information. Yeah. And secondly, there are places in the callee where the value actually is lost, because it can be in a no return path, it can be after the return, it can be in some places where it just doesn't need the value anymore, and then it just has reused the register without saving the value anywhere. So in that case, it's completely lost.
But
and then you can still go back to the call site and try to figure out where did the caller set it to, and that's what this comes in.
Yes.
But I think it's an interesting question, whether it would help, in some cases at least, if the compiler would do that.
Yeah. Presumably you're going to lose the call site value stuff just as often, because I mean that only exists, right, if the caller has generated the value of where to put this thing somewhere.
Yes.
I suppose, because it's always going to put it on the stack, so it's always going to be a known field. It's not just going to...
Yeah, yes, okay. I mean, often it's going to be on the stack, in which case you will have a call set information, because if it's not, then... So I guess we're all in agreement there that there are many more places. It's not 100% solvable for every case, but it would be solvable in theory, at least in many more cases than GDB currently solves the problem.
Yeah, right. So here are some of the restrictions. The call site information is sometimes not available, of course. One prominent example is if you don't have any debug info, but you have unwind info, then you can unwind usual stuff, but you cannot get to the location of R2 anymore. But also, if the compiler didn't track variable locations, you don't have call site information, and that is the default with O0, unfortunately, right now, because no variable tracking is done with O0. So that's also something that we may want to discuss at some point. Whether that should change, I don't know.
Maybe GCC could. Yeah, it doesn't do var tracking because generally we don't need to track variables in O0. But if we use the call site info for things like the return location, then maybe even at O0, GCC could still emit a dwarf record for just that.
Yeah.
If not for everything. Yeah, I mean, it's just call site info is part of var tracking today in GCC, and that's if var tracking is off, then you never get any of that.
Yeah. And of course, even if var tracking was done, there is no guarantee that R2 is reconstructable by GCC. So it's possible that it's lost, or var tracking got lost track of it.
I mean, GCC is generating the code to use the return value unless
the return value,
is not used.
Right. For example.
Thank you.
Or only part of the return value is used, or the return value is supposed to be constant, or whatever. Yeah, you know.
Or as was mentioned in the last talk in the auditorium, the return value is optimized out entirely.
Yeah.
Directly or indirectly. SRA, IPA.
Okay, yeah. So, yeah, I think we can do something about this, at least improve the situation in GDB by using this call site information. That is not done today, so that would be something new. And I looked into that a little bit, but I haven't really come up with a patch yet. So, the next larger topic here is transactions. Transactions are also not specific to Z. Right now, I think all major platforms have that. And there are probably similar problems with regards to debugging on all of the platforms with transactions. So transactions are ways of executing an instruction sequences atomically, more or less, and they have an interesting feature that they can abort. And More interestingly, maybe the intermediate state is not observable, also not by a debugger. So whenever you try to observe the intermediate state, then the transaction aborts. So you don't get to that state. And when debugging things, this is obviously a very big obstacle. So what this basically prevents is all kinds of debug scenarios, right? At transaction begin, one thing that works on our platform at least is we can actually step over a transaction. So when at the transaction, then executing all of it at once, that actually works with single stepping. But this is not necessarily what the user expected when doing the single step. That's the only thing to preserve transactional behavior. But what certainly doesn't work is if you're hitting a hardware breakpoint or software breakpoint at the transaction begin or within the transaction, or if you try to step into the transaction, if you try to record a transaction, all of that does not work. Same as with watch points. So basically, in all of these cases, what happens is that the transaction is aborted and you get back to the transaction begin. And depending on which logic is executed in GDB after that, you can even get into an endless loop or all kinds of crazy stuff. Or get a GDB, get GDB confused about what happened, because we had a breakpoint hit at some location, but now we are at a different location. So yeah, this is all not working correctly right now. I talked about that also 4 years ago in the GNU Tools Cauldron in 2015, and I provided some more details about this. The various scenarios there. So if you're interested, I will not repeat all of that here now. It's a bit too long, I guess. But the bottom line is, all of this is basically broken right now. One interesting twist on Z is that the Z architecture provides constrained transactions. Constrained transactions have limitations about their size. They have a limited instruction size and also a limited number of instructions. They have a limited working set, so how much memory they can touch. And it's very interesting. It's limited to 4 octobwords, so 4 contiguous aligned regions of 32 bytes at most. And constrained transactions can only use a small subset of the Z architecture, cannot branch backwards, so that there must not be any loops. But if you then follow all these complicated restrictions and constraints, then the hardware guarantees that such constrained transactions will complete eventually. So there is no abort handler required, and forward progress is guaranteed by the hardware. So that is a very interesting synchronization feature. I haven't seen it used widely yet, but that's also why we still have problems in GDB. Otherwise, we might have done more about it. So maybe a little bit improvement would be possible here. By the way, even with the other transactions, there might be some improvements possible. I didn't talk much about that because I already mentioned it in the GNU Tools Code in 2015. But just to give you an example, GDB could at least indicate that something interesting has happened here, that the breakpoint was in a transaction and the transaction was aborted, and that you better remove the breakpoint from there before continuing, because otherwise you will hit it again. Things like that, right? Could be done, or it could be a bit more automated also. And then you could also maybe do something with imposing some assumptions about your program, that your program is basically self-contained and doesn't have any conflicts with programs outside the control of GDB, and then you can also maybe do a little bit more, like emulating the transactional behavior, right? But all of this is fancy stuff and a lot of work, I guess. Yeah, back to constraint transactions. So in this case, we can maybe also do something special. This is just brainstorming at this point, I guess. So nothing done here yet. So for example, recording a constraint transaction. Right now, if your program contains a constraint transaction, the recording is broken, right? Just doesn't work. So we could probably do that a little bit better when assuming that there are no conflicts outside of GDB's control again, right? By looking at the whole code and then recording whatever that code touches, right? Or what that code may touch. Then display stepping could also be improved, I guess, by displacing the whole transaction and stepping that. That's also something that doesn't work right now with transaction at all. With the larger ones, it's not feasible, of course, because we don't know where they end. It's impossible, basically, to find out where they end. I don't know. Well, maybe there are some more things. So I guess all platforms are affected by the limitations that I'm listing here, more or less. But I guess, are there any other experiences with that?
These transactions things with the abort handler, it sounds very similar to restartable sequences in the Linux kernel. It's something very recent. I don't know if you've heard about that.
Yeah, I've heard about that.
Okay, it's my colleague Mathieu who works on that, and there's a talk about it tomorrow. Mm-hmm. But basically, he has the same problem where if you try to single step the restartable sequence, you keep going back to the beginning. So his solution is he's trying to add a new system call, which is to allows you to ask the kernel to do a certain set of operations on a certain CPU, which would be basically, okay, since I'm not able to execute this region, I'll have the kernel do it for me as a, it will look like one operation that will be single steppable, and then we'll be able to do forward progress. So if this system call gets accepted, I guess it could be used here as well.
Yeah, the problem here is that we are interfacing not with the kernel, but with the hardware. So we don't need just another system call. I think we need another hardware feature. And that we would need for all platforms then.
It might be, I'm really not expert on that, but it just makes me think about this.
Yeah, and right now we don't have that, at least not sufficiently. Okay, the third problem I'm talking about is really more specific to Z, but it might be interesting nevertheless. So if you have this situation here, where a result is a variable in a floating point register, and we are one frame below and go up that frame and try to display the result variable, which is located in F8, then GDB shows it as optimized out right now. Optimized out is also very confusing because the compiler didn't do anything wrong. Compiler actually represented the variable correctly, and it's not optimized out, of course. GDB cannot access the contents, cannot access the variable. cannot access F8 in this case, because it cannot unwind F8. Without unwinding, everything's fine, right? And the variable is not shown as optimized out. So what happened here is very unfortunate. F8 is actually a sub-register of the vector register 8. And it's also interesting, I haven't debugged this yet because I didn't have the time, but what I expected GDB to show here is that result is a variable in V8. I don't know why it doesn't. I haven't really had the chance to look at that. But anyhow, so, and V8 is partially clobbered. The right half of V8 is basically clobbered, so V8 cannot be unwound completely, and then GDB doesn't unwind it at all. And not unwinding it at all, and then trying to take part of it, a value from part of it, yields this optimized out expression then. Yeah. So basically, what we need here is partial unwinding for that vector register in order to fix this. We have a similar situation already with the 32-bit ABI with the GPRs. There are 64-bit GPRs, but the ABI basically only deals with a low 32-bit of them. So only the low part can be unwound, and the rest is clobbered. And currently, GDB already does unwinding or emulates the unwinding of the full GPR by installing an unwinder that performs a cast, basically. It casts the lower half to the target type. Unfortunately, that's only part of the solution because that does not yield an L value. So you cannot change a variable through that interface. You can only look at variables through that interface, right? So, yeah, we could do something similar, of course, still for the vector registers, but there's also a different solution. I posted a different solution some time ago to the mailing list. It was also not perfect, and it's not upstream right now, but the idea was that we hack into the value from register architecture hook and provide one. We already provide one for S390 where we ensure that values are taken from the left end of any vector register or of any floating point register, but values are taken from the right end, so the lower end, of any other register. It's a big endian platform, remember, right? So on the big endian platform, the lower end is on the right-hand side, in my mind at least. So, yeah, it's a bit confusing. That's what this value from register hook does right now. So the idea was that we could also exploit that hook to take the value from the sub-register instead. In order to avoid having to unwind the full register, right? Just divert to the subregister that we can unwind, and we have already unwound. And that's nice and all, but it's also not a full solution. The real solution would be to do actual unwinding of the vector register in this case, namely to construct the full value for that partially unwound register, which can then yield an L value, but you can also cut out any pieces of that thing. Yeah. So the approach would be to write computed value functions for accessing such a partially valid register, and to install an unwinder that yields such a LVAL computed value with these functions. But then also, and I haven't looked into too much detail there, we probably have to teach GDB at some places, and maybe many places, I don't know, to deal with partially valid registers, because that's not what GDB can deal with today. Whenever GDB deals with registers, or at many places at least, it assumes that the registers are either completely valid or completely invalid. And we have a lot of functions that deal with this stuff. This is only a part of it, of course. These are just the functions that read registers from a frame. Yeah.
So it's been a few years since I looked at the unavailable support in GDB. Mm-hmm. You know, instead of saying optimize out, you can also say unavailable.
Unavailable, yeah.
Yeah,
I know.
And the support for that, and later also for optimize out, supports only pieces of a value being unavailable.
Mm-hmm.
You can.
I know. Yeah, yeah.
Single bit, right?
Values can be partially unavailable. Yeah. That's for sure. Yeah.
That's not completely hooked to register values, right?
Right.
Right. Is that like the direction you would head towards?
Yeah, that's a question.
It would be.
That would be solution two, basically. If we choose solution two, then at least all of the logic required to deal with that would have to be adjusted to be able to deal with partially valid registers.
So when you have a partial register available, it's like you have like one large register which has a name, and then the part that's available has like a different name for that sub-register? Do you have like...
No, I would just represent it as a usual value, right? With computed value functions that represent valid or invalid pieces.
Questioning.
Or what?
Maybe I don't know how to formulate the question. Okay. I kind of understood it that like you have to have a large register called maybe V something.
Like this?
V8, and then you have F8. And
mm-hmm.
like F8 is not going to be available, but the other half is going to be or something.
F8 is available and the other half is not available. Yeah.
So on the command line, if you reference F8, that data should be available, right?
That is already the case.
So what
but
fails
V8
is
if you try to show V8, then it doesn't show anything.
Okay. What would you want it to show?
I mean, right now V8 is the default type for V8 is a union, and I would at least want to show the valid part of the union.
Okay. It sounds to me like you would want to fix the parts of GDB that the register values that are not integrated with the unavailable marks in values.
Yeah, maybe that's necessary, yeah.
And it doesn't sound to me like you would need to use an LVAL computed for that. Maybe I'm wrong about that, but it just sounds to me like it's an LVAL register with half of it marked unavailable.
No, you have to compute the value somehow. I mean, the value happens to be the same as F8 right now. And the idea is that we compute V8 basically from that. Or what do you mean? I think you mean that we don't even consider F8 at all anymore, in this case.
So a value is like an array of bytes, the contents of the value.
Mm-hmm.
And when you create the value representing V8, you would fill
the
available bytes you have from F8, and then the rest would be marked unavailable. And if you try to print V8 in a scalar form, it's going to error out. You cannot convert the whole thing to a scalar. It's just plain nonsense. But if you want to print it as a union, then the slices that fit inside V8 would show something, and the slices that overflow F8 would show unavailable or optimize out or something.
I haven't looked into whether that's feasible. The idea that I had was that F8 can already be unwound, and it's probably easier to reconstruct V8 from that rather than teaching all the unwind logic to deal with partially valid registers as well. I mean, the dwarf logic, for example, right?
I don't have a sense whether it's lots of work or not.
Yeah, I don't know. It was just a feeling that it might be easier this way around. Any other questions? Okay, then another similar issue, not the same, but similar, is with composite locations, with FPRs. So back to our long double type. The long double type is very interesting. That type causes another problem here, namely, look at this code here, where long double result is set to 42. And this is not optimized code, of course. Yeah. So it's actually set to 42. And then we print the value that should be 42 now. It shows 0. So the problem is we have a dwarf location for this. That is a composite location with two pieces of 8 bytes. And they are taken from the two vector registers shown here, V8 and V10, right? So I can also show it here. The pieces are taken, or they should actually be taken from the left-hand side, but they are not taken from the left-hand side, because GDB doesn't take pieces from the left-hand side at any time, never. Yeah, it always takes pieces from the least significant bit end, basically. And on big endian platforms, this is the right-hand side. And on the right-hand side, we have zeros in this case. So we compose a value of zeros, and that yields a zero instead of the real value that we want. So this is pretty bad, and it's also a long-standing problem, and also posted a patch some time ago for that. It's also not perfect, or also not complete. So the idea for a fix is that the piece offset has to be adjusted by per register, right? Some registers are anchored on the left-hand side, at least on the Z architecture, and this is the case for vector registers and floating point registers. They are just anchored on the left-hand side, right? On the, if you will, on the more significant end. Yeah, they are anchored there, and integer registers are anchored on the lower end side. So, and what you probably always want is that you want to take pieces from the anchored end by default. So
I have a question about this. I remember you went through all the piece code to deal with big endian, and there was like a thread on dwarf discuss. Was that a different set of big endian bugs, or was it the same?
The bugs that I dealt with in GDB were various problems with the piece handling logic in GDB.
Okay.
This is a specific one for Z, and I discussed this with the dwarf people.
Okay, and is this without the solution they wanted? Like debuggers should know about endianness anchors?
No,
or?
I didn't understand what they wanted.
The only reason I bring that up is I just wonder when I see this if the fix is to fix dwarf or fix GDB or fix the compiler, you know, because
yeah,
it could be done anywhere, and the question is what's the
right. This is also one of the reasons why this is still open,
yeah,
because it's not obvious where to fix things and what exactly to do in some cases.
I feel like we have a coordination problem because dwarf is a little bit difficult to get answers out of, you know, so.
What about the LLVM side? Does the dwarf information coming from there represent exactly the same, and do we have to apply the same logic, or maybe they have a different interpretation of dwarf, and then GDB would not have to do this dance of left and right? Right? It's the same question he's having, but in a practical sense.
Yeah, this is a good question. I don't know the answer, but I'm sure we can find out. So, I mean, we do the same thing. So we use the same vector, the dwarf numbering, because that's the ABI, and so that we use the same number that we used to use for the floating point register, now for the vector register, that's the same. Whether LLVM generates exactly the same dwarf for the piece thing, I don't know, but I can check.
If I recall correctly, I tested that at some point, and it did. I hope that's correct. Yeah. So anyway, the idea is that we just provide a register anchor information in GDB that can then be used by the code or by the logic that cuts out pieces from registers. So ask the hook and then use the left or right offset calculation based on what comes out of it. Yeah, and we already touched on the question about dwarf. The dwarf standard right now, I consider inconsistent, and I requested fixing it, but it didn't change at all. So for the piece operation, the dwarf committee at some point, that was the first operation that was designed, right, the piece operation. And for that operation, the dwarf committee decided that the location of the register, the location of the piece within the register is defined by the ABI. And I think that's a good idea. And then we made use of that, basically. But then the bit piece operation was designed, and then at that point they decided that they should go for something different this time. And they chose to state that it's now based on the least significant bit end of the register. And that really doesn't work for vector registers on Z, because at some point we didn't have vector registers, we only had floating point registers, but they have the same register number. So if we anchor them on the right of the new vector register, then we would come up with negative offsets or whatever. Really doesn't work, right?
I don't really understand that, but I think for the defined by the ABI part, I feel like that language is pretty clear, and that an architecture hook in GDB would be perfectly fine.
Yeah. So.
I think the inconsistency comes here because you have a definition for piece and you have a definition for bit piece, which is different. And then you also have people who treat sort of piece as just identical to bit piece times 8. And that's where, and in fact, GDB code does that.
And GCC and code does that.
Where the inconsistency comes in. So.
Yes, I wrote a lot of that piece code, but I don't think I had a big Indian machine or gave it any thought whatsoever, so, you know. But in GDB, I mean, I feel like if there's, okay, for bit piece, I mean, the inconsistency is bad, and that's, like, just bad. You know, and if someone's on the dwarf committee, maybe they could try to fix it. However, it's also clear, you know, and so we could change GCC and GDB to conform to what it says, and then it would at least, like, make sense according to the standard, just like we would fix a bug.
Well, it's
for conformance it's broken to any standard, you know.
Either way.
Well,
so
okay.
My preference would really be to fix the standard.
The other thing we could do is file bugs against the dwarf standard and say this is just broken.
I've tried that. Maybe
reasons.
Somebody else would.
Well, And then instead of using dwop bit piece, use dwop gnu bit piece, which does the right thing, and just not use this ever.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, that's terrible, but.
I guess the alternative would be to add a new dwarf op, but that takes from the most significant bits instead of the least. But I mean, I guess it's unlikely to happen.
Right, and the other perspective is what actually matters, right? If you have 1, 2, 3 compilers doing something and all of them do the same thing, then you have binaries in the field already, 10-year-old binaries, and you want to debug them. So you made GDB work this way. And then you have LLDP working this way because all the binaries already work this way, and Clang works this way, and GDB work, GCC works this way. At some point, the whole ecosystem is broken in term in when you look at from the eyes of the standard. Then you can also be pragmatic and say, well, why do I care about that? Just the standard that's broken. Right? Why go through the trouble of creating new things, changing in a backward and compatible way, just making problems for users, if we could just change the standard or create some annex, some ABI specification for S390, say, ignore what they say for bit piece. Yeah, we do it this way, right? I think there's a balance here. I wouldn't say it's just very clear to that we should fix it in the tools.
Yeah, there are also some
just
other
playing devil's advocate, I guess.
That's fine.
Yeah. Okay, so whatever.
I want to respond to that just really quickly. I mean, I don't disagree with that. It's just I feel like that's a workaround. It's an admission that we can't coordinate through the standard. You know, it's broken. It's like, you know, and I mean it is, and that maybe that's the best thing to do. But it's like, you know, it's disappointing.
Yeah.
All right.
On the other hand, the impact might be limited to just one architecture. And so maybe it's OK to do something that breaks compatibility because it's for the benefit of the one architecture where the breakage is happening.
Yeah, just to be clear, I won't stand in the way of any patch that works. I'm happy with that.
I think one thing is clear. We all have difficulties interacting with the dwarf standard. It's a slow process, and it's not an isolated case. But
in this particular case, I have a feeling that I wasn't very good at conveying my message very well. At least it didn't end up. I didn't get a feedback that indicated to me that I was really understood. So I think up until the end of the discussion. The dwarf people didn't really understand what I was trying to tell them. That's my feeling. And the discussion went on pretty long, so.
There's one interesting tidbit here is that no one from the GDB community is part of the standard for several years. There's no one in the standard that's a GDB maintainer.
I tried to tell that one of the dwarf committee folks, and he vehemently disagreed. He said that Andrew is still there. Yes, I don't know. I don't remember that having heard any names. Maybe he didn't actually tell names. But then I looked out through the dwarf committees, and there were some people who contributed or had contributed to GDB at some point.
Yeah, that's correct, Andrew.
Yeah. Yeah, Andrew was one of them.
But some of the Apple people, I think, are still in the committee that now work on LLDB.
Yeah.
Maybe Jason, I think, is over there. I'm not sure.
But yeah, I think basically no currently active developer or maintainer is.
And that's not I'm not trying to point fingers at blames because myself, I've never volunteered for that. It takes effort to do that, of course.
Yeah, I understand. Yeah. Mm. Okay. 5 minutes left for class. Yeah, the last thing is not very big anyhow. This is also something that we cannot do much about. I just wanted to indicate it here because it may not be known to everybody, and it is probably interesting a little bit. So with watch points on Z, we have some hardware limitations. The implementation of watch points on Z is based on a hardware facility that is called Program Event Recording. And with that facility, we can watch a single contiguous address range. The good thing about it is that this address range is arbitrary. It can be arbitrarily large. Yeah. It can also be byte aligned. So it's really a completely arbitrary address range. But then there are some limitations, namely access watch points are not supported. So we can also only trigger on writes, not on reads. We also trigger after the fact. So then the value has already changed. That's bad. And one thing that is pretty disturbing is that the same address range is also used for hardware breakpoints. So you can break on a large memory region. Hardware breakpoint, as you can set a large hardware breakpoint. So whenever reaching this region, break. But then you cannot set any watch points anymore. So the current approach, how we use this feature in GDB is that we only allow hardware breakpoints, one hardware breakpoint or watch points, and we allow multiple watch points, and then we basically define an address range spanning all of them. So there are some problems with that, and these problems, I mentioned these here because some of these problems prevent test cases from succeeding. Yeah. So one thing is that far apart watch points can be slow. I think that is not something that any test case stumbles across, but it's certainly something to keep in mind. But a more prominent problem is that multiple watch points, if you set multiple watch points, then you don't know which one you hit, because you hit this address range, but where? Yeah. This could be improved a little bit by looking at the instruction that caused the watch point hit, and basically disassembling that instruction and understanding the instruction, and then determining the address that was used for that instruction, and then, yeah, things like that. Then we could derive from that information which watch point was hit. That's some work that hasn't been done yet. But the other problem is in the multi-threaded case that we can miss value transitions because of races, right? The value can change back and forth, and if the same value appears again before I look at it, then I think nothing has changed and I don't show the watch point hit, right? Just continue. That's what GDB does.
Watch points trigger on that architecture before the change is effective or after?
After.
That's the at the hardware level? It's already after, like at x86?
Already after, yeah. Okay.
Does the second point there, multiple watch points, you don't know which one hit. If you have two watch points with some space in between them, does it mean you'll also get false stops where it's just some write to random memory and you don't know?
That's part of it, yeah. You, not only don't you know which one you hit, you don't even know whether you hit one of them.
And going back, like.
That's the first point. Your firebug can be slow because you will have many hits in between.
Oh, I thought it was some hardware thing about being slow. And then about the hardware breakpoints, can you just use memory breakpoints and not hardware breakpoints?
Sure, yeah. Software breakpoints work like usual.
Okay.
It's just a limitation for the hardware breakpoints.
A suggestion, if you go back one slide, where, yeah.
This one?
When you describe the features of the hardware, it was the one before. You said, well, it's about the ranges. There's one command in GDB. It's called break range, which is exactly like that. So you can expose that feature, a breakpoint that triggers if any address in this range is executed.
Okay. I'm not sure we do that right now. I don't think so. Yeah, that must be interesting.
Break range.
Mm-hmm. Okay, yeah. Question?
The multi-threaded issue can miss value transitions. Do you think it's an issue for other architectures too?
I think there are some other architectures where the watchpoint hit is indicated after the fact. Is that right?
x86.
Yeah. So if like value goes from 0 to 1, then GB is woken up and then checks. And in the meantime, there's this other thread that sets the value back.
Yeah.
Yes.
And then from the point of view of GBO, the value hasn't changed while resume the first thread.
You have to remember how watch points work. What the normal watch command is watch expression. It's not watch a location of memory, right? Unless you use minus location and use a read watch point or an access watch point. The normal watch point is watching expressions.
Yeah.
So the watch point triggers, and the next thing GDB does is compares the new value with the old value have recorded, stored in its memory, compares them. If they changed, then it reports a stop to the user saying, you know, memory changed, and you see that in GDB. Mm-hmm. New, old value, new value, GDB shows them. And that's the problem, is the comparison between old and new. If the watch point at the hardware level triggers after the memory has been already changed, if you have two threads at the same time changed in the same memory, you have two traps at the kernel level, at the hardware level, at the kernel level. But when GDB goes and reads the value and compares it to the old one it had stored, it may find out that the value is still the same because it had flipped on and off. Oh, it's still the same, so I'm just going to resume execution, just on stop. But in fact, it did change twice.
Right, that's the point.
So in that sense, this race condition is just it's just a fact of the semantics of the GDB watch command itself. The difference, maybe, where our platform is different than others, is that in other platforms, you could use things like the access watch point, which is more defined in sort of terms of hardware. Whenever an access to this thing happens, you get an intercept in GDB, even if the value is the same. And we can't do that because, the hardware doesn't support it. First of all, it doesn't support breaking and read. And secondly, it doesn't tell us if we had a write hit in that big range. We just get an exception that this was hit, but it doesn't tell us where. Therefore, if we use the big range to implement multiple watch points, we can't say which one of them hit. So on x86, I think you have those four registers, and it will tell you which one of them triggered it.
Yeah.
And if that was selected as an access watch point, then this will be always reported as this is the one that now triggered.
Yeah.
And that's what we can't do.
Yeah, we could do that. Yeah. Okay, so that's it. Any questions?
Do you happen to know what any of the ZOS debuggers do with regards to transactions?
No, not really.
Just shot in the dark. They might do something interesting, or they might do the exact same thing. It's it's probably something worth investigating, at least at a surface level.
Yeah, maybe. I really don't know what they are doing. Okay, thank you.